This is video three for chapter eight on metamorphism and metamorphic rocks. I want to discuss metamorphic environments. When we think of metamorphism, it can occur in a variety of environments, oftentimes near plate margins, and sometimes associated with igneous activity. The basic metamorphic environments include contact or thermal metamorphism, hydrothermal metamorphism, burial metamorphism, subduction zone metamorphism, and regional metamorphism. There are a couple of other ones I'll mention after I go into detail about these first five. This figure is a pressure temperature depth diagram, and on it are plotted the different metamorphic environments. For example, you can see that hydrothermal metamorphism occurs in a low temperature, low pressure environment. Contact metamorphism is affected by temperature more than pressures. Burial and subduction metamorphism is at greater depths and moderate temperatures, and so forth. Contact metamorphism, sometimes called thermal metamorphism, occurs when a magma body intrudes the surrounding rock and essentially bakes it. And you get a zone of alteration, we call an aureole, that forms immediately around the magma body. The conditions for contact metamorphism are low pressure, high temperature. I want to focus on this figure over here. Here we have a magma body that is intruded. The country rock that in place is a limestone, quartz sandstone, shale. As the magma intrudes this country rock, it metamorphoses the rock, and the limestone becomes a marble, a quartz sandstone, a quartzite, and a shale becomes a hornfels. So this is the zone, the aureole, around this magma chamber. Once again, temperature is the primary mechanism in contact metamorphism. Hydrothermal metamorphism deals with water that is ion-rich and hot, and it circulates through pore spaces and rock fractures. Generally, hydrothermal metamorphism occurs along mid-ocean ridges, but it can occur on continents where there are hot spots. Associated with hydrothermal metamorphism are black smokers, which I will show you a picture of. As an example of hydrothermal metamorphism on the continents, here we have a hot spring and geysers. So this area is sitting on top of a mantle plume. So in this case, it is not along a mid-ocean ridge where the hydrothermal metamorphism is occurring. Once again, typically where we think of hydrothermal metamorphism occurring is along mid-ocean ridges, as shown here. Cold ocean water seeps through the fractures in the basaltic ocean crust, being heated then by magma, and then coming back up. And what we get is this plume of hot mineral-rich seawater, oftentimes that will precipitate out economically valuable minerals. Two rocks that are the product of metamorphism on the ocean floor due to hydrothermal metamorphism are the rocks serpentinite and soapstone. So these are hydrated rocks, meaning they have water in their atomic structures. Another type of metamorphic environment is called burial metamorphism. This is where sedimentary strata build up in thickness in a subsiding basin, and the weight of the overlying sediment that continually is deposited in this basin, essentially metamorphoses the rocks at the bottom of the sediments. So confining pressure as well as heat drive recrystallization. Subduction zone metamorphism, the sediments and ocean crust get subducted fast enough that pressure increases before temperature. So differential stress is a player when it comes to subduction zone metamorphism. Regional metamorphism is the most common widespread type of metamorphism and is associated with mountain building. In this situation, the crust gets shortened and thickened, folded and faulted. Here is a visual of regional metamorphism. We have an ocean basin being subducted beneath a continent. Eventually, the ocean basin is completely subducted away, and you have continent-continent collision, which has great stresses, differential stresses, and creates metamorphic rocks. And also, there's a mountain building going on as a result as well. A couple other metamorphic environments I'm going to mention quickly are metamorphism along a fault and impact metamorphism. Here is a fault area and in a diagram here. And if you're up near the Earth's surface where the rock is cold, the crumbling of the rock, we refer to it as a fault breccia. Down deeper in the Earth where the rocks are warm, rather than a brittle behavior, we get ductile behavior, and the rock is called a myelinite. Here's a picture of a myelinite here. The textural variations within metamorphic zones, we can start with slate, which is a low-grade metamorphic environment. At higher grades, we get to phyllite and schist, and at the highest grade, gneiss is the rock that we get. As we go from low to high grade metamorphism, a couple of changes occurs. The grain size enlarges, and the minerals change from low temperature to higher temperature minerals. Looking at this figure here, we start with the sedimentary rock shale. Low-grade metamorphism, it becomes a slate, phyllite, schist, gneiss, and once we get to a high enough grade, it may start to melt where we would get a migmatite. Another visual showing the actual pictures of the various rocks, we have the slate, very fine-grained flat layers, foliation is flat, whereas phyllite is still a fine-grained texture, however, the layers are no longer flat, but are wavy. Schist is the metamorphic rock where we get to crystals that are large enough to be seen with the unaided eye. So we're at a high enough temperature pressure regime where recrystallization has caused the minerals to be large enough to be seen. And finally, at the highest grade are gneiss, we actually get a separating out of the ferro and non-ferro magnesium minerals into layers. As I mentioned previously, one of the changes that occurs during metamorphism from low to high grade is changes in mineralogy. What we use are what are called index minerals, and index minerals are indicators of the grade of metamorphism. One note here, I mentioned migmatites on a previous slide. These rocks are part igneous and part metamorphic. They represent the highest grade of metamorphism, and so are transitional to igneous, and actually are part igneous. So this is an example where you can't put this rock in any one particular rock group. It is both igneous and metamorphic. Here are our metamorphic zones, low, intermediate, and high grade. Our transition from a shale to a slate, phyllite, schist, and gneiss, and the index minerals that we would find in these various grades of metamorphic rocks. So if you have chlorite in your rock, it indicates a low-grade metamorphic rock. Sillimanite on the other extreme would represent a very high-grade metamorphic rock. So chlorite, muscovite, biotite, garnet, starlight, selenite, those are good index minerals. Quartz and feldspar are not good index minerals because they are actually stable over the entire zone of metamorphism. So when you find them in your rock, it tells you nothing about temperatures and pressures. The index mineral garnet indicates that this metamorphic rock is intermediate to high grade. This shows an area of the Northeast that has been mapped from low grade, intermediate, and high grade, back to intermediate and low grade. So across this zone from New York all the way through New Hampshire, our main metamorphic event was going down through the center here. And based on index minerals, it was determined where the low, intermediate, and high grade metamorphism occurred. Here's a picture of that migmatite. It's part igneous, part metamorphic. The white layers are igneous, the dark layers are metamorphic. Metamorphic rocks that have the same mineral assemblages indicates that they formed in a similar metamorphic environment. We call these metamorphic facies, and they include hornfels, that is actually misspelled, hornfels, zeolite, green schist facies, amphibolite, granulite, blue schist, and eclogite. These facies tell us specifically about what type of environment the metamorphism occurred in. Once again, pressure, temperature, depth diagram shown here, and the placement of all the different facies. So a granulite facies would be a very high temperature, moderate pressure to high pressure environment. Blue schist facies would be in the subduction zone area where you have very high pressures. Eclogites are found at the highest grade of metamorphism in a subduction zone where temperatures and pressures are very great. We can say that high pressure, low temperature metamorphism is associated with the upper part of a subduction zone, whereas regional metamorphism would be associated with colliding continental blocks. And finally, low pressure, low to high temperature metamorphism is associated with divergent plate boundaries. These diagrams have a lot of detail in them, but they are listing the type of metamorphism and then the associated facies with that metamorphism. Eclogite, as an example, would be a subduction zone metamorphism. Eclogite, high temperature, high pressure, so it would be in the bottom part of the subducting slab. Once that ocean has been subducted and we have continental-continental interaction, here we go from low temperature, high pressure, all the way to high temperature and high pressure environments, type of metamorphism, regional metamorphism. And looking at our divergent plate boundaries, hydrothermal metamorphism is associated with divergent boundaries, and burial metamorphism also as a low temperature, low pressure metamorphism occurring in basins. And the zeolite facies would be the facies associated with that. Here are a couple of examples of metamorphic rocks. A blue schist forms in low temperature, high pressure environments. Eclogite, high temperature and extreme high pressure environments. Going back a couple slides, here's our eclogite, here's our blue schist. So this is a subduction zone regime. Wrapping up here, some minerals are only stable at certain pressure and temperature regimes and are excellent index minerals. An example are andalusite, kyanite, and sillimanite. And knowing the pressures and temperatures that these three minerals are stable at can help us interpret the metamorphic environment. Andalusite, you can see, is more of a low-pressure mineral. Sillimanite, high temperature, high pressure. Kyanite, moderate temperature, but definitely high pressure. So if you have a metamorphic environment that is plotting here at point X, you would expect to find the mineral kyanite. Something that plotted along this line here would be an area where sillimanite and kyanite are both stable. And this purple and blue line, that would be where andalusite and kyanite are stable. This is the triple point where all three minerals would be stable. That wraps up our video 3 for metamorphic rocks.